Tabernacle Man.
Teaching biblical principles to a sight and sound generation.
3,500 years ago, the Tabernacle of Moses was the first portable sanctuary for worshipping the Lord. When Moses ascended Mount Sinai, the Lord was very specific with regards to the pattern that needed to be followed in order to construct the tabernacle, and he was very clear that Moses should not deviate from this pattern whatsoever. So why is it that we as believers need to study this pattern today? Is it possible that it could have any relevance for the Lord's people in this day and age? And could it seriously give us any insights into our own spiritual walk by studying this ancient form of worship? Our hope for today is to answer these questions and more as we introduce you to the purpose, the plan, and the pattern of the tabernacle.
And thou shalt make the court of the tabernacle. For the south side southward, there shall be hangings for the court of fine twined linen, 100 cubits long for one side. And the pillars thereof shall be 20, and their sockets 20, of copper. The hooks of the pillars and their fillets shall be of silver. And likewise for the north side in length, there shall be hangings 100 cubits long, and the pillars thereof 20, and their sockets 20, of copper, the hooks of the pillars and their fillets of silver. And for the breadth of the court on the west side shall be hangings of 50 cubits, their pillars 10, and their sockets 10. And the breadth of the court on the east side eastward shall be 50 cubits. The hangings for the one side of the gate shall be 15 cubits, their pillars 3, and their sockets 3. And for the other side shall be hangings of 15 cubits, their pillars 3, and their sockets 3. And for the gate of the court shall be a screen of 20 cubits, of blue, and purple, and scarlet, and fine twined linen, the work of the weaver in colors, their pillars 4, and their sockets 4. All the pillars of the court round about shall be filleted with silver, their hooks of silver, and their sockets of copper. The length of the court shall be 100 cubits, and the breadth 50 everywhere, and the height 5 cubits, of fine twined linen, and their sockets of copper. All the instruments of the tabernacle, and all the service thereof, and all the pins thereof, and all the pins of the court shall be of copper. Exodus chapter 27, verses 9 through 19.
What I want to do is take a few moments and just explain the pattern that Moses was given for the altar of burnt sacrifice.
And he made the altar of burnt offering of acacia wood. 5 cubits was the length thereof, and 5 cubits the breadth thereof, 4 square, and 3 cubits the height thereof. And he made the horns thereof upon the four corners of it. The horns thereof were of one piece with it, and he overlaid it with copper. And he made all the vessels of the altar, the pots, and the shovels, and the basins, the flesh hooks, and the fire pans, all the vessels thereof made he of copper. And he made for the altar a grating of network of copper, under the ledge round it beneath, reaching halfway up. And he cast 4 rings for the 4 ends of the grating of copper, to be holders for the staves. And he made the staves of acacia wood, and overlaid them with copper. And he put the staves into the rings on the sides of the altar, wherewith to bear it, he made it hollow with planks. Exodus chapter 38, verses 1 through 7.
So what we have here is an altar, a grill, if you would say, that is made of acacia wood planks that are covered with hammered copper to protect the wood from burning. Copper conducts heat and spreads it out, so it's not going to burn through in any one particular place. You'll notice that in many versions of the Bible, it describes the size of the altar of burnt sacrifice in terms of cubits. And remember, a cubit is basically the measurement from a man's elbow to the tip of his finger. And commonly it's said that a cubit in the Bible represents 18 inches. So this particular instrument is 4.5 feet tall. It's in measurements of cubits, and 5 cubits square, 5 cubits in each direction, and those cubits translate into 7.5 feet. So what you have is a wood box covered with copper that is 4.5 feet tall and 7.5 feet square. You will notice that there is a rock ramp, rock and dirt ramp. These materials would not have been hewn with hammers or axes or anything. They would have been taken from the ground as they were and used to build a ramp, a structure, so the priest, when he's presenting the offerings, can walk up to the fire and place the offerings on the grate. Now, what is important for us to learn today is just this basic structure. So you can see that it's on 2 mounds of dirt. The reason why it's lifted up and a ramp to go up to present is because you have to have some way to put the firewood in to keep it burning. You have to have some way to pull out the ashes that have burnt down from the coals to remove them, because we know that if you do not remove the clinkers in our life, if you do not remove the dead ashes and put new fuel in, the fire will go out. Now, Scripture tells us that the original fire was lit by God. After 7 days of inauguration and ceremony of instituting or inaugurating the tabernacle, on the 8th day, everybody was waiting for the first service to happen, and it says that basically God was pleased with the pattern. And when the pattern was right, the fire fell and lit the original firewood of the altar of burnt sacrifice. And you can see our flames are rolling in our footage, and to kind of give you an idea of what that might look like. It says that there were 4 horns, 4 protrusions on the altar itself. Now, horns in the Bible are a symbol of strength, a symbol of power. I asked one rabbi one time, why does the altar have 4 horns on it? And he said, well, it's got 4 corners, so 4 horns. And then he smiled and he said, how many horns do animals have? And I go, well, usually 2. And he goes, well, that's natural power or strength. God's altar has 4 horns, much more power, much more strength. I don't know if that's true, but I'm going to go with it, okay? Now, let's not get too caught up in were these like literal horns on an animal. It's basically talking about some protrusion that comes up on the altar of burnt sacrifice. Now, there are some Jewish writings that indicate, in the Talmud, that these were more square instead of pointed, and that there was like a cup inside, and this is where the priest would pour the blood on the horns of the altar when it was prescribed to do that. So the blood wouldn't have been running down all over the altar. It would have been in this cup that would have been inside this little square protrusion. That's where the blood would be poured. And after a while, it would dry up just because of the heat emanating from the altar of burnt sacrifice. The scripture tells us that the pots, the fire pans, the flesh hooks, the shovels, even the container that the ashes would be taken away from the altar were all made of copper. And remember, copper doesn't shine like the silver that was used, doesn't shine like the gold that was used. But this is a symbol of how God can take something common and elevate it to sacred or holy purposes when it's been set apart for him. But I can't show it to you in particular today, but if you take a penny, if you take an old penny or an old piece of copper and you take and you clean it, it does shine. So even something that is made of common metal can be used for holy purposes. But even like in our lives, even though we might get tarnished, even though we might get singed or burnt or have soot build up in our life spiritually, we can be cleansed. We can be made whole. We can actually be set apart, made holy, set apart for sacred purposes. I know that for some of us that's hard to think because of all the things we've done in our life and before we become conscious of God, before we even thought of attending any type of religious services, before we even considered the value of prayer and spirituality, we may have picked up a lot of baggage along the way. But the ministry at the altar of burnt sacrifice then was about restoration, was about reconciliation with God. It was about repairing torn relationships between not only God and man, but man and man. So this is the first portion or first piece of holy vessel or furniture that you would see. It's also, if you'll look again at the model, it's the largest piece of furniture associated with the Mishkan. Some say that you could take all the other furniture, the copper basin, the menorah, the table of showbread, the golden altar, and even the Ark of the Covenant and place it all inside here. It wouldn't do that. No one would have transported it that way. Everything had its own mechanism for transport. But the point is, as soon as you walked in the gate, the first thing that you saw, the thing that you couldn't get away from, is the ministry at the altar, the brazen altar, the altar of burnt sacrifice. Well, let's proceed a little bit and go to the next piece of furniture that was used in the ministry at the Mishkan.
And the Lord spoke unto Moses, saying, Thou shalt also make a laver of copper, and the base thereof of copper, whereat to wash, and thou shalt put it between the tent of meeting and the altar, and thou shalt put water therein. And Aaron and his sons shall wash their hands and their feet thereat. When they go into the tent of meeting, they shall wash with water, that they die not, or when they come near to the altar to minister, to cause an offering made by fire to smoke unto the Lord. So they shall wash their hands and their feet, that they die not, and it shall be a statute forever to them, even to him and to his seed throughout their generations. Exodus chapter 30, verses 17 through 21.
Come with me. We're going to go just a little bit past the ramp here. And what I've done is I've taken the copper basin, which would probably be a little bit further away from the ramp. It would have been back over this way. But for the purposes of the camera, so we can see this a little bit better, I've inched it forward some. and you can see that it basically is a two-part piece of furniture. It is made of solid copper. It's not made of wood overlaid with copper. We will learn in future lessons that this was made from the copper mirrors the ladies brought from Egypt, part of the spoils of Egypt. It's two pieces. There's the bowl proper, and then there's the base. We're not told how large this is. We're not told how wide it is, how tall, any of the dimensions. We're primarily told what it was made of, that it was two parts, and that it was made of copper and what it was used for. Every morning before the priest would begin his ministry at the altar of burnt sacrifice, before he would represent the people, before he would inspect offerings, before he would do anything, he would first come to the brazen altar, the copper basin for washing, and he would ceremonially wash his hands three times and ceremonially wash his feet three times. We sometimes are mistaken that here is where the animals were washed and cleansed. Not so. That was done on some tables on the north side of the altar of burnt sacrifice. This was just for the priest. It was a way of sanctifying. It was a way of making holy. It was a way of setting apart their activity that day. They were to make it holy, to make it sacred. This was not common duties. This was not everyday life. This was something associated with God himself. Some say that there were spigots on the side, and that's how they got the water out, and that there was a lid on this so dirt would not come in throughout the day or the evening. So we got the altar of burnt sacrifice. We got the copper basin for washing. And just behind me is the Mishkan, or the tabernacle itself. Now, this structure is 15 feet high, 15 feet wide, and 45 feet long. Now, let's go back to the model just for a moment and take off the four coverings and look inside. So the first part you see in the model is the holy place. We've just come through another veil, and that holy place is 15 feet high, 15 feet wide, and 30 feet long. And inside the holy place, you have the menorah. It's on the south side. On the north side, you have the table of showbread. And somewhere in the middle, up against or near or facing the veil that separates the holy place from the Holy of Holies, you have the golden altar of incense. Now that we've looked at the model, let's take a look at the full-size representations of the holy place. Let's go inside the tent.
Many times over the years, Dr. Harman has been asked if his pictures of the high priest's garments and the tabernacle were available for the general public. We're pleased to announce that two new resources for ministers, rabbis, Sunday school teachers, and anyone waiting to make their Bible's reading come alive are now available. The garments of the high priest contain the eight golden garments of the high priest, as well as the four white linen garments of all the other Levitical priests. The pattern of the tabernacle contains more than enough slides for the teacher who wants to deliver several stunning lessons on every part of the tabernacle of Moses, including the altar of burnt sacrifice, the laver, the menorah, the table of showbread, the golden altar of incense, and the Ark of the Covenant. These two resources will capture the attention of your congregation, young and old alike.
We just left the outer court where the altar of burnt sacrifice and the copper basin for washing were located. Out there, we prepared ourselves to draw closer to God by presenting our korban, our offerings. So we were prepared for the way of God. Now we're inside the holy place where we're going to learn the truth of God. Remember, the holy place is just the first compartment in the tabernacle proper. Behind me is the Holy of Holies. The holy place, the dimensions are 15 foot wide, 15 foot tall, and from this veil to the veil where the five golden pillars are would have been 30 feet. Remember, in the Bible, this is usually spoken of as cubits, and a cubit is from the tip of the elbow to the tip of the finger, about 18 inches. So inside the holy place, we're going to learn the truths of God.
And thou shalt make a table of acacia wood. 2 cubits shall be the length thereof, and 1 cubit the breadth thereof, and 1.5 cubits the height thereof. And thou shalt overlay it with pure gold, and make thereto a crown of gold round about. And thou shalt make unto it a border of 1 handbreadth round about, and thou shalt make a golden crown to the border thereof round about. And thou shalt make for it 4 rings of gold, and put the rings in the 4 corners that are the 4 feet thereof. Close by the border shall the rings be, 4 places of the staves to bear the table. And thou shalt make the staves of acacia wood, and overlay them with gold, that the table may be borne with them. And thou shalt make the dishes thereof, and the pans thereof, and the jars thereof, and the bowls thereof, wherewith to pour out of pure gold shalt thou make them. And thou shalt set upon the table showbread before me alway. Exodus chapter 25, verses 23 through 30.
And we will learn that from the table of showbread, where the 12 loaves of bread, one representing each of the 12 tribes, was placed on the table. There was 2 containers with frankincense on top. And this frankincense, during the morning prayers, would have been burned on the golden altar of incense. And remember, the hot coals that fueled the incense waffling up in the tabernacle, those hot coals came from the altar of burnt sacrifice and no other place, no strange fire, so to speak. So with the table of showbread that was exchanged every Shabbat, every Sabbath, a new 12 was put in, and it represented how God sustained the people from the earth, from the ground, from the seed and the rain and the harvesting. So the truth that we learn from the table of showbread is that God sustains us. To my right is the menorah. Now, the menorah was the only source of light within the tabernacle.
And thou shalt make a menorah of pure gold. Of beaten work shall the menorah be made, even its base, and its shaft, its cups, its knops, and its flowers shall be of 1 piece with it. And there shall be 6 branches going out of the sides thereof, 3 branches of the menorah out of the 1 side thereof, and 3 branches of the menorah out of the other side thereof. 3 cups made like almond blossoms in 1 branch, a knop and a flower, and 3 cups made like almond blossoms in the other branch, a knop and a flower, so for the 6 branches going out of the menorah. And in the menorah 4 cups made like almond blossoms, the knops thereof, and the flowers thereof. And a knop under 2 branches of 1 piece with it, and a knop under 2 branches of 1 piece with it, and a knop under 2 branches of 1 piece with it, for the 6 branches going out of the menorah. Their knops and their branches shall be of 1 piece with it, the whole of it 1 beaten work of pure gold. And thou shalt make the lamps thereof 7, and they shall light the lamps thereof, to give light over against it. And the tongs thereof, and the snuff dishes thereof, shall be of pure gold. Of a talent of pure gold shall it be made, with all these vessels. And see that thou made them after their pattern, which is being shown thee in the mount. Exodus chapter 25, verses 31 through 40.
And the menorah had 7 branches, the center branch is sometimes referred to as the servant branch. And inside each of those little lamps would have been olive oil. And that would have produced the fuel for the lamp, for the light. And the wicks would have been made out of linen. Now, where did they get the wicks? The wicks would have been produced from the soiled garments of the high priest. Not the golden garments, but the white linen garment. When that became too torn or worn to be used, it was shredded into strips, and that was used for the wicks of the menorah. Now, then we have the golden altar of incense, sometimes just referred to as the golden altar, and it was standing right in front of the veil separating the holy place from the Holy of Holies.
And thou shalt make an altar to burn incense upon. Of acacia wood shalt thou make it. A cubit shall be the length thereof, and a cubit the breadth thereof. 4 square shall it be, and 2 cubits shall be the height thereof. The horns thereof shall be of 1 piece with it. And thou shalt overlay it with pure gold, the top thereof, and the sides thereof round about. And the horns thereof, and thou shalt make unto it a crown of gold round about. And 2 golden rings shalt thou make for it under the crown thereof, upon the 2 ribs thereof, upon the 2 sides of it shalt thou make them, and they shall be for places for staves wherewith to bear it. And thou shalt make the staves of acacia wood, and overlay them with gold. And thou shalt put it before the veil that is by the ark of the testimony, before the ark cover that is over the testimony, where I will meet with thee. And Aaron shall burn thereon incense of sweet spices every morning. When he dresseth the lamps, he shall burn it. And when Aaron lighteth the lamps at dusk, he shall burn it, a perpetual incense before the Lord throughout your generations. Ye shall offer no strange incense thereon, nor burnt offering, nor meal offering, and ye shall pour no drink offering thereon. And Aaron shall make atonement upon the horns of it once in the year, with the blood of the sin offering of atonement once in the year shall he make atonement for it throughout your generations. It is most holy unto the Lord. Exodus chapter 30, verses 1 through 10.
Now there are some that say that the golden altar of incense was more toward the front of the holy place, so you would enter into the place of prayer before you acknowledged God sustains you and that God provides direction or light for you. But most say that it was closest to the veil. Now let's look at the dimensions of each of these holy vessels. Now the table of showbread is made out of acacia wood, and the acacia wood is then overlaid with gold. You'll notice that there are 4 rings on it, but the staves or the poles are missing because once it was put in place, just like the golden altar, once it was put in place, the staves were removed. So the table of showbread is 36 inches long, 18 inches wide, and 27 inches high. And you'll notice that there is a crown molding, a rim around it, and that's to keep the bread and the cup and the frankincense and everything from falling off when it's being transported. Bread would have always been on there, of course, exchanged every Sabbath. To my right is the menorah, the only source of light, as we said. Now, the Bible doesn't say how big it was. It does say how much it weighed. We do know that there were seven branches. We do know that it was fueled by olive oil. We do know the wicks came from the high priest's linen garments once they were no longer being used. There is some talk that the branches wouldn't have been curved, but they would have been straight because of the Hebrew word is more like a reed. But it's known best because of it's a symbol of Israel. It's on the Arch of Titus. So most show the branches curved. But the most important piece is that it was hammered out of one piece of gold. Quite a bit of work, probably about 75 to 90 pounds worth of gold. So today it would be quite expensive. The golden altar is 18 inches square. So 18 inches this way, 18 inches that way, and it's 36 inches high. In the center here would have been a bowl, and that bowl would have been used to house the burning coals, and the incense would have been placed on that every morning and every evening. And just to recall, Aaron, the high priest, would come in, and every morning he would trim the wicks and place hot coals and incense on the altar. And every evening he would take and replenish the oil in the menorah, make sure that they were kindled, and then once again place more hot coals from the altar of burnt sacrifice and more incense before the Lord. This is the holy place. Let's take a look inside the Holy of Holies.
And Bezalel made the ark of acacia wood. 2 cubits and a half was the length of it, and 1.5 cubits the breadth of it, and 1.5 cubits the height of it. And he overlaid it with pure gold within and without, and made a crown of gold to it round about. And he cast for it 4 rings of gold, in the 4 feet thereof, even 2 rings on the one side of it, and 2 rings on the other side of it. And he made staves of acacia wood, and overlaid them with gold. And he put the staves into the rings on the side of the ark to bear the ark. And he made an ark cover of pure gold, 2.5 cubits was the length thereof, and 1.5 cubits the breadth thereof. And he made 2 cherubim of gold, of beaten work made he them, at the 2 ends of the ark cover. 1 cherub at the one end, and 1 cherub at the other end. Of 1 piece with the ark cover made he the cherubim at the 2 ends thereof. And the cherubim spread out their wings on high, screening the ark cover with their wings, with their faces one to another, toward the ark cover were the faces of the cherubim. Exodus chapter 37, verses 1 through 9.
As you can see, we're now in the Holy of Holies. First, let's look at the size of this compartment. It is 15 foot tall, 15 foot wide, and 15 foot deep. Now you'll notice in the Bible it speaks in terms of cubits. And in biblical times, a cubit was basically from the tip of the elbow to the tip of the top finger, and that's about 18 inches. So when the Bible talks about a cubit, it's basically talking about 18 inches. So we have the Holy of Holies here, and you'll see that surrounding the Holy of Holies, we have those silver sockets that were purchased with the atonement money that we talked about in previous lessons. So these are the sockets that are in the ground, and they hold up the gold planks of acacia wood that's overlaid with gold. So when we come to the Ark of the Covenant, you know, basically it's the safety deposit box. Inside the Ark of the Covenant was the Ten Commandments, the law. Now you'll notice that to the right side of the Ark, that you'll see the pot with manna and you'll see Aaron's rod. I've purposely left it out for a lesson down the road. There is some disagreement as to what was contained in the Ark of the Covenant, how long the various things stayed in there, when it was taken out, what happened with the Ark in general. But for now, we just want to look at the overall Holy of Holies in the Ark of the Covenant. So as far as dimensions, in the Bible it'll give it in cubits, but I'm going to give it to you in inches. First of all, this is the front of the Ark. This is not the side. Often you will see pictures of the Ark of the Covenant, and it'll have the poles going this way. That's incorrect when you look at the Hebrew. The side of the Ark is this side and that side. This is the front. This is the rear. So that's why the poles are going this way toward you. So the Ark is 45 inches wide, 27 inches deep, and 27 inches high. Now, many believe that the cherubs, the two cherubs on top of the mercy seat, were about 28 inches high. In some commentaries, it'll talk about hand breadths and different things as a measurement. We're not sure exactly what these cherubs look like. There's a lot of speculation, a lot of different theories and understandings. When we focus on the Ark of the Covenant and that lesson in particular, we'll go into much more detail. So we've got 45 inches by 27 inches and 27 inches high and probably about 28 inches for the cherubs. You'll notice that I have the acacia wood poles overlaid with gold, and they are in the Ark of the Covenant. Scripture is specific in that the poles were never taken out of the Ark of the Covenant, out of the golden altar of incense, out of the table of showbread, out of the altar of burnt sacrifice. Those staves or poles were removed once the article was in place. But the Ark of the Covenant, the poles remained. Once again, when we get to the detailed lesson, we'll speak about that. So I want to talk about just a few things to help you understand this overall view of the tabernacle. Actually, the Ark of the Covenant could be considered two holy vessels or two pieces of furniture. The box-like structure on the bottom is actually the Ark, the container, the box that kept the covenant of the Lord, God's contract between himself and man. This top portion here was called the mercy seat, and this is where the high priest, once a year on the Day of Atonement, would sprinkle the blood seven times. We'll look at that in more detail at another time. So this part here could be considered the Ark of the Covenant, and then the second piece, the lid or the mercy seat. Now, the mercy seat would have been able to be lifted off by a couple of men, and you would have seen the contents of the box. So here we have it, the Ark of the Covenant. Now, you'll notice that this one looks different than the one that you're most familiar with. Most are familiar with the Ark from the Indiana Jones movie of the 80s, and you can see a picture of that that replica on your screen right now. That ark really isn't to biblical dimensions, but it's the one that's most familiar with people. So just keep in mind that the Ark of the Covenant was the only piece of furniture, the only holy vessel inside the Holy of Holies. It was made of acacia wood, just like some of the other furniture, and it was overlaid with gold. The poles were acacia wood overlaid with gold.
Thank you so much for sharing this time with us. Truth of the matter is you could have been somewhere else watching something else, but instead you chose to be with us, and for that we are so grateful. Our goal here at Kohanim Ministry is to present biblical principles to a sight and sound generation.